Hello everybody, welcome to another Arkham Horror the Card Game list video. Today we're going to be talking about our top 5 event cards. I'm looking forward to this one. It's a good time seeing everything come together. We're going to talk about some fun stuff. There might be a few surprises on the way, but let's see. Starting with number 5, Bryn, what's your number 5?
I've got First Watch. You just get to pick where all of the games cards go this turn. Like nobody gets blindsided by anything except sometimes you buy like 3 cards because nobody else can handle them. But yeah, mm-hmm. It's basically like the game just doesn't get to play this turn.
Yeah. I feel every time you play this card, or I think Travis, have you played this card when we've played?
I played Zoe, yeah.
Yeah, you did. Yeah, that. Every time it happens, I feel like you guys are like wrapping your arms around me in a big hug and saying, "Don't worry, I got you. You're safe."
Yeah, just yeah. Like I think First Watch is like borderline a blue staple now. It's so good.
Yeah, it all
in multiplayer groups anyway.
Does like an incredible taunt impersonation, mm-hmm. where you're just like you're across the map, but you were gonna draw this, but I drew it instead.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
like I'll
no, very good.
Yeah.
My number 5 is Delve Too Deep. I have a lot of emotional positivity when it comes to this card in the past, even though sometimes...
Are you sure it's positive?
Yeah, no, but honestly, there's actually only, I'd say, one time when Travis, you did this, and it was, like, bad. Every other time, it's good. Like, and... There's times.
Well, it might not have been good in the moment, but like at the end, it was good.
Yeah,
but like, you got that victory, and you were like, you know, it was worth it.
Yeah, the only time that wasn't was that one time we were doing Dunwich when it got a little bit out of hand. But
I mean, like that wasn't entirely my fault.
No,
it was like a little bit, but like
it was Brent and I's fault for not being prepared for the challenges that awaited us in the game. You were just keeping us honest.
What if you had overzealous in your deck?
I do wish there were more cards that had this kind of interaction. I feel like Delve Too Deep is a very strong version of it, and I think the next ones need to be a bit weaker, but I do wish there was more ways for players to sacrifice their starting deck building and then giving experience, because at the same time Delve Too Deep is going to be replaced, so you're basically putting these into your deck being like, I'm excited to kind of make things a tiny bit harder for victory. It does become like, it's such a fun card, and I've liked it since it's released. And, I mean, it came out in Dunwich, so, like, it's been out in the game for a long time. And in today's recording, I was reminded why I freaking love this card, right? Like, yeah. if you play really well, it's such a huge boon for the game. For the players, not the game.
Yeah, like, I agree that Delta Deep's a little bit on the strong side for this kind of effect. And maybe some kind of Guardian event where, like, you flip until you hit an enemy, and if you kill the enemy this turn, you get an extra experience or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I agree. I would like to see more of these investment opportunities.
I do feel like the only colors that should have it are green and purple, just because they have like blue and yellow do have expensive cards, but like you can get by with less experience. Like, but with green and purple, you're like buying big stuff. So I feel like it's in their colors.
I like the purple ones. I mean, I kind of hate Sharon's Obol as a design, because it's like, you just get free experience for winning anyway.
Yeah.
And it's like...
Yeah, I think I talked about in the Relics one, I like Sharon's Obol, but it's a bit... In multiplayer, there's like, if someone buys it in multiplayer, you're like, yo, dude, what are you freaking doing? Like...
Yeah, like, not that it's a bad decision, it's just like, kind of not fun.
Yeah, exactly. Travis, what's your number 5?
Ever Vigilant. I have liked this card since I tried on a whim in a Mark Harrigan deck back in the day, I think. It was the first time Sixth Pine came out or something like that. I don't remember exactly, but playing 3 of your cards and like basically gaining 3 resources in blue is really, really good.
Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah.
You're gonna notice on my list that you each have like your colors that you're assigned, or not assigned, but that you play. Brim plays green cards, Justin plays red cards. And mine, I have 0 green or red cards on my list, spoilers, because I play the other colors. but yeah, like, Elder Vigilant is economy, action efficiency, all for a single experience.
Yeah.
Like, that's really good.
And just being able to Like if, because with what's that? Stick to the plan. Is that the one that you have?
Stick to the plan is the permanent.
Yeah. So and like you, because and then like being able to play your whole hand and be set up on turn one is fantastic.
Oh yeah.
Very strong. All right. Number four, Bryn. Your number four is.
This card is like 1,000 times better than I've ever given it credit for. Sure, the downsides kind of suck, but if you can't discard an item or an ally, are you really playing purple?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes the ally you discard is, you know, like Daniel, whatever his name is.
David Renfield.
David Renfield. His name's not Daniel at all. But
we call him that though off camera.
Yeah, yeah. Or some sort of other thing that has Doom on it, mm-hmm. and when you don't have to discard it, you just pay three to take, you know, like four or five move actions. Like,
yeah,
this card's awesome. Plus, you get to whisper about Astral Beast.
Yes,
that's pretty cool.
Yeah, no, I've noticed that it was our Forgotten Age one where you were playing this one in your Safina deck where you were like, let's go, and I remember a very clutch Astral Travel in. The City of Archives, which was really sweet.
It's like elusive but not broken.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, yeah, it's almost exactly like elusive but as it should have been.
Yeah. My number four is Eucatastrophe. This card's fun. I like saying it's a Eucatastrophe every time it happens. And it can do very broken things. I've never done the Silas build with it. I think I said that on the exact last episode for this list series that we do. This reducing the skill value to zero, it's like it's nice there, but man, does it feel good to turn an auto fail into a blessed symbol. Like that's where you feel like the spiciest boy in the world when you're able to do something like that. And it makes it so that you can like resolving your star symbols is very fun, and being able to do it consistently is also very fun. And I am excited to eventually do the Silas build where it just loops this forever, but I still have some other things I want to try out with him first.
Yeah, maybe we'll do a run where we play like just broken stuff.
Yeah. Travis.
My number four is Prepared for the Worst. It's the other blue event on my list. Prepared for the Worst is here because it really changed how the game played for us when it was printed. This didn't come out till, I think that's like a 100-ish.
Yeah, 184.
Card number, yeah. So like quite late in the Dunwich cycle. Probably pack, Mythos pack 4-ish. And like, so we played this game a fair bit where you just had to like hope to God that your goon could find a weapon, and sometimes they didn't, and you were like, shit.
you had to hope that they could find one of their four weapons that did extra damage, or at the very least one of the two other weapons they were playing to try to make sure they could find one.
Yeah.
That just made it easier for them to fight.
This card like really changed the game as a whole, I think. It really put an emphasis on Fantasy Flight, that they wanted the classes that did things to be able to do them consistently.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a good design decision to make. Like, you don't want the difficulty in the game to be like, well, I couldn't draw a weapon in time, I guess we just lose.
Yeah.
Right? That's not fun. Like, if your weapon isn't good enough, that's one thing, or if you just draw bad shits, like, that is a difficulty of the game, but not even having a chance to do it is not fun. And I think this card was a very good design decision on their part, and I'm very appreciative of it.
Yeah, well, it allows, like, now that the assumption that this card's out, players will have quicker access to their weapons, so the scenarios themselves can also, like, move quicker, and that's what makes the game a bit more exciting, too, right?
Yeah, it does also make it like, a better, not just a like better feel to spend experience on bigger weapons, but like it is a better game decision as well.
Yeah.
Because it's easier to find the one that you spent your XP on, right? Like if you paid a bunch to put a flamethrower in your deck, it would suck if you didn't see it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
One thing that like I guess is bad about these kinds of cards real quick is that like it does kind of pressure players into purchasing an entire collection or purchasing certain packs to get their specific cards for their decks.
Yeah, that's a very fair point. And especially if it's like it's one, like, can you imagine, like, everyone was like Echoes of the Past, they couldn't get it. If there was like a really good player card in Echoes of the Past, that would be a bit unfortunate.
I remember that was an issue with Charisma for a while.
Yeah. But yeah, no, I think that is very fair as well.
That's a pretty minor issue, I think.
Yeah, I agree. All right, number three, Bryn, your number three is?
I got Perseverance. I don't know, if you guys watch us play, you probably have noticed that I die a lot more than the other two combined. Perseverance is like, this card costs two and it says, why not die? How about not that?
There's a lot of scenarios where we're like, I don't know if we're all making it out of here, and Justin and I both look at Bryn. And Bryn's just like, okay.
Man, yeah, that's the thing. Travis and I can either say, Bryn, you got this, and Bryn always just like, no problem.
Yeah.
And then afterward, then he's looking at his hand, and he's like, all right, I have a little bit of a problem.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow, you never want to portray weakness to your team, right?
It's true.
But also, this card at its actual worst is Guts, and I'm not going to go into why that's good here, because that's not what we're here to talk about.
Let me get my notepad.
We could
do brain symbols. It's pretty strong.
I'm sure one of us has it written down somewhere.
Yeah, like even in the worlds where you're not like, I'm going to die unless I play Perseverance, it still does work.
Yep, definitely. My number three is Scrounge for Supplies. There's a lot to like about this card. Number one, it costs zero, and I like playing no resources in my deck. It's more fun that way to just be a poor little baby. Number two, this card is very, very, very strong, and it can allow you to do a lot of really just do the cause it's like another like a level zero warder protection, right? Or my final reason for having this, it's like another copy of my number one card on my event card list. So we'll get back to that later. But I just think Scrounge for Supplies it's a killer card. And I was very excited when it was released.
It's very flexible.
I have not had a chance to play with that card yet, but you could use this card to get Perseverance back.
And you
just
could.
Forever.
Oh, maybe. Man, you could.
Maybe I should try that.
Matt, one day, Justin, you're going to have to play like a blue deck or something like that. And you're going to be like, what's an economy? I just filled my deck up with the cards I want to play.
Yep.
Why can't I pay for all these?
I mean, I can adapt. It's like, but it's, you know, I see red and I see a number on a card. I'm like, there's a misprint on this card. It doesn't say zero. Well, I shouldn't play it. This is probably
where are my best cards free?
Yeah. Travis, what's your number three?
I got Deny Existence. Specifically the level 5 one, because it's like the super cool one, but the level 0 one is also very, very good. This is the ultimate, like, screw you to the game.
Yeah.
Where they try to make you do something, and you're just like, nah, man, I'll do the opposite. And the game is like, mistaken. Okay, guess I'll lose then. Like, yep, throw your hand, nah, draw 5 cards instead. You know, you're going to get chunked for 3 brain damage off of Iron Remains, who cares, just heal 3 instead.
Yeah,
like, it's so cool. The art's beautiful. It's got fantastic subtype and paradox. It's very fitting of the effect.
Mm-hmm.
The level 0 one is like, again, one of them purple staples where like you should have a very good reason not to be playing in your purple deck, assuming you have the card. Commits for a while in a pinch. Has to be like a very hard pinch though.
Yeah.
Because, like, how often... It's not very often you're going to have a test that, like, this card doesn't... That you need to pass, that this card doesn't fix the result
of. The only time is you have 2 actions left. One is to resign so you don't lose because of Doom's going to take over next turn. And the other action is to pass a must-pass test. That's when you...
Yeah, you're like, I need to get this clue this turn or something.
Yeah.
But it's just... It's a really cool card. It's very flashy. This is the Seal of the Elder Sign event. You know, it feels so good to play.
And I think what also is just like the best one from is just when the game says discard cards and you say, no, actually, I think I'm going to draw cards instead. Thank you very much.
Yeah, don't mind if I do.
Yeah. Cool. All right. Bryn, what's your number 2?
Man, so for a long time, this would have been my number 1. Sleight of hand is one of my favorite green cards to play with. I'm glad. I actually had Justin's on my list as well, and it was kind of a toss up between the two. I'm glad I didn't pick that one. But under the current rules, sleight of hand can only put cards into play that require one or less hands, less than two hands.
As it should be.
Which is like, you know, it's understandable. It fits within the flavor of the card. You can't really sleight of hand, like, you know, a machine gun into play, I guess. Though it was fun when you could. but even now, there's a lot of cool stuff that you can sleight of hand into play, particularly things with limited uses. You sleight of hand it into play, you burn through it in the turn, and then you just pick it up.
Yeah.
Like, you sleight of hand your Lupara into play, you blow away two enemies.
And then it's back.
Put it back in your hand. You're ready to go again.
I remember the it was like 2017, 2018, maybe 2018 when Brynn was in the sleight of hand part of the game where he was like, I'm gonna build this deck where I sleight of hand all these big things in.
No, I remember playing two player contact Brynn that, and he was like, check this out, it's my sleight of hand. I'm like, Brynn, just play something good, damn it. I just wanted to like play the scenario normally.
Yeah.
The greatest memory I have of this card is playing it in a Leo Anderson deck and getting to sleight of hand the BAR into play. And just one like time. Yeah, you just run through all its ammo in a turn because it's a machine gun and you can very easily do that. Mm-hmm. And you're like, suck it, Yig.
Yep.
Yeah, that's sick.
My number two is you handle this one. I think it's funny. I think it's like, honestly, it... So, like, Ward of Protection, because, like, in the design, it was, like, a perfect purple card. And this is, like, a perfect green Mythos deck manipulation card. Because you can just, like, give your problem to someone else and just put your hands up and be like, sorry, bro, by the way, I'm making a dollar off of this. and this is kind of like Watch This, like... where there's just, I just find the card to be so freaking funny. And it's even better, like, when you give it to someone and, like, then, like, you're just sitting there watching, feeling all comfortable. Then all of a sudden things start going bad for them because of that card. And you're just, like, like looking down at your cards being like, oh, shit, did I do that?
Yeah, I think my greatest regret about our all-green run is that we weren't all playing this and so that we never had a... chance for Justin to be like, nah, Travis, you handle this one. And Travis be like, nah, Brynn, you handle this one. And me be like, ah.
Just shuffle on the table as the first person again. They're like, hmm.
Yeah.
So into funny. That brain test, Finn.
But I also don't think, I think some people, when they read the card, they might be like, oh, this is bad. I give the card to another player. But I mean, like, if it's a brain test, give it to the purple player and they're totally fine. Like, it's a very strong card too. Like, it's
actually like a Ward of Protection kind of.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it's Mythos deck mitigation and it's very green Mythos deck mitigation. You're not saying no, you're just saying, hey, you handle this one exactly.
This is the kind of Mythos deck mitigation I like to see in other colors.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, and like I said, it's like perfect green manipulation.
I like this one and I'll handle this one a lot.
Travis, what's your number two?
This is Shortcut. I've played this card a lot, and every time I've played it, or like any time I've drawn this card or had one of my teammates play it, I was like, it's a good card.
Yeah.
It's just, it's not flashy, it's not exciting, it's just...
It's good.
Good.
Yeah.
I don't know, reactions are good.
I've been playing this game with my family, and I'm trying, we're playing the Forgotten Age, and I'm trying to explain why somebody else should explore, because if they find the place that we need to go to, I can bring the last person with us and we can dodge the poisonous spores that are going to kill us.
And they're like, no.
But you're, no. Why can't you just find it and then bring me with you? Like, no, I can't do that.
Yeah. So good.
Oh yeah, Shortcut's just, again, it's a staple of the color.
Yeah. It's just,
there's lots to say about it, but most of it's like information that you could glean from playing it a couple times.
Yeah, it's just, it's good.
Yeah.
Is it good?
You ever wanted to move and not spend an action on it?
No.
Done.
It's good, it's fun, it's, like, admittedly low impact, but, like, always relevant.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah, if you ever play a game and you find yourself not wanting to play Shortcut, then I have to question which scenario you were playing and why it's part of the Forgotten Age and you failed to explore.
Why can't you just bring me with you? I'm going to ask that so many times when we play Return of the Forgotten Age.
I'll kill you.
All right, let's go to our number ones. Drumroll. Brian, your number one is?
Yeah, so...
the only surprise.
I had never played Practice Makes Perfect until very recently. But every time I played this card, I had to double check and read it again and make sure that I wasn't cheating because it felt so strong. Like, it barely even matters what color you're playing that isn't yellow. Like, the practice cards for that color are all very good. The only issue is making sure that they're all something that can be committed, or that you have, like, enough of them that can be committed to the same type of test to feel comfortable rolling it out on, like, you know, an investigation test, or, mm-hmm. you know, like, against the Mythos deck, or during an attack.
But, like, odds are, if you've built your deck, you know what it's for, and you can just run it and not worry.
Yeah, and like getting to pay one to play Deduction twice, or play Vicious Blow twice, because Vicious Blow is also a practice skill.
It's strong.
Yeah, like it is very powerful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm excited to try it out too. The first time I think I saw it played that I remember was in your Rex deck, but.
Yeah, that's mm-hmm. That was the first time I had played it. But yeah, like even hitting two of the basic colorless skills,
mm-hmm.
I think it's Perception and Manual decks, are practiced as well.
Mm.
So like even hitting one of those and being like, I'll pass my test because I got an extra +2 to it, and I will draw a card, and I will put the skill back into my hand so that I will pass the next one because I have +2 to it, and I will draw another card.
Yeah.
That's very strong.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, the only downside to this card is when it's, like, low in your deck, and you're like, I don't know if there are any practice skills left in my deck.
Yeah,
because, you know, there's, like, 5 cards left in this pile.
But then you're yellow, so just draw through the rest of your deck, and then it's all good again.
Yeah, like, it's a solvable problem.
My number one, to the surprise of nobody watching this video, is luck.
A negative amount of people.
Yeah. The card is great. I think it's up there as one of the strongest cards in the game. It's just such a big safety net for your game. My only complaint about it, they fixed it, was the fact that it costs 1, and now there's a one that costs 0 that's even better. I don't like it's like Shortcut as well, like where it's like the card just kind of just sums itself up, right? Like it's a very strong card, and I like playing it.
If you can't figure out why Lucky is good, maybe you've never played this game before.
Mm-hmm. And then it's also the time where just like the silence that always happens with mostly Brent and I. Travis has played Lucky a few times, but it's mostly Brent and I. You reveal a token, look at your hand, and be like, "Nah, I'm Lucky. Like I got this. It's all good."
Easy.
Travis, what's your number one?
So Warrior Protection is my number one, and if it wasn't my number one, I wouldn't be surprised to see on the other two people's lists, specifically level 2 version. I've played this card a lot. Our group has played this card a lot. I'm surprised that my copies don't have, like, Riffle Shuffle markings on them. It's been played so much. I truly believe this is one of the best cards you can play in a multiplayer thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's so good.
Oh, yeah.
Like... it stops Ancient Evil, so it's... I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah, I think this is exactly where I would have put Ward of Protection if it were on my list, is in Travis's pile. Because, like, I don't play this.
These are my top 10. These are my top 5 events that my friends play.
Yeah.
No, it's really good. The level 2 version in particular is on the list because it helps your teammates specifically. The level 1 version also very good in pretty much every circumstance, and the level 5 version is like even better for solo play.
Yes.
Yeah. Or If you're playing like with two people, it's pretty
good. If you're playing two-handed, it's also like incredibly strong. You just get to stop a thing.
Yeah. With this one, like,
I mean, even
you go, Travis.
Even two players, I think I'd rather play the two experience one than put that three experience towards something else.
Yeah, and like, yeah, that's the same. Like for us, like we stop at two because we play three player, and like it's like chef's kiss at three player. Man, when are they gonna make Ward of Lucky where you can use it, play it on another player?
They did.
Why am I having a stroke?
It's the starter deck, you chimp.
Which one?
The starter deck.
It's the one in the starter deck.
Yeah, the upgraded one works on any
player.
Yes,
the level 3 one is free. Yeah, you can play it on other people.
I didn't even know that part of it, and I thought the card was incredible. I didn't even know you could play it on other people. I was too busy thinking about myself. Oh my god, it's even better. Oh my god.
Yeah, no, it's Ward of Lucky now.
Wow. I didn't even know that. That's incredible. Man, you guys just made my day. Sweet. All right. Well, what's everyone else's favorite event cards that are watching this video? Let us know what we should do next. I think next on our list, we're going to be doing top 5 assets. And then I need to see. Have we done allies? We've done allies, right?
I'm pretty sure we've done allies.
Yeah, if we've done allies, it won't be after that. But if we haven't done allies, expect that in the future as well. As always, recommend any list ideas. We do look through and add them to our ever-growing ideas for these list videos. Thanks for watching, everybody. Have a good one. And as always, GG's.